All right, good morning. My name is Alessandro Barbieri. I'm part of the product management team here at Pluribus. And my job right now is to walk you through the fundamentals of our architecture. This is really a launchpad for Sune, which is going to follow up this presentation to really deep dive. So I'm going to really step it down probably 3-4 levels and we're going to build from there. So at Pluribus, the philosophy or the approach of our technology is really we start off a server perspective. So we take an off-the-shelf servers, which means high-end CPU configuration, high-end memory configuration, high-end storage configuration. And as importantly, this is not just about hardware, it's actually about how the operating system controls the hardware and the different peripheral devices. The operating system, whether it's a Linux or OpenSolaris, builds a map of the entire hardware and controls it at very high speed through the PCIe type of buses, but fundamentally very high speed connectivity. So we start off with this very simple concept, and I've highlighted one particular peripheral device, the NIC. Because at Pluribus, what we've done is extremely simple. We've just replaced the NIC with the most powerful switch chips from merchants that merchant silicon money can buy today, pretty much, right? So what this means is actually three things. Number one, what we have here is an architecture which doesn't rely on any software coming from merchant silicon vendor. We build from scratch software which controls the entire stack from the chip all the way up to the applications running on top of our platform. And this means that this switch chip here is fully mapped into the operating system memory, much like is a NIC card or any PCIe attached device, and you control this at very high speed. We also throw into the picture here a multi-10 gig port connection to run services and control plane type of applications between the switch chip and the server operating system. And this is very much unlike any traditional switch. In a traditional switch environment that you can buy from any vendor out there based on merchant silicon, what you have is the operating system talking to a couple of millions, 3, 4, 5 million lines of code to control the switch chip as sort of a black box. And that interaction occurs over a very low speed channel. What we have here, we're completely opening up the infrastructure. Now the chip is fully mapped into the operating system and you control it at very, very high speed. For us, the switch chip, the analogy between the switch chip and the NIC actually runs very deep, much like a NIC today is used for TCP offload functionalities and other flow acceleration functionality. For us, a switch chip effectively is nothing but an application flow accelerator. Yes, it's also a full-blown layer 2, layer 3 device, but also is an application flow accelerator. So the philosophy of the server really carries very deep into this infrastructure. Now, I want to actually open up a little bit the lid on our server switch, showing you what's inside, and then we jump on to the virtualization aspect, because this is the last piece of our infrastructure. So this is really the server switch, right? Effectively, it's a switch. Okay, it's a device that sits in the network. It has 48 ports of 10 gig, 440 gig uplinks. There are several configurations, and this is the back and this is the front, right? Just to make it more real than just a logical diagram. So what's inside the box you've just seen? Today, as we speak, you can order that box with a Broadcom Trident 2 configuration inside, or you can order another variant with a full Chroma Alta chip from Intel. Okay, very powerful, very low latency switch chips available today. On the F line, which is associated with the Alta switch chip, we also have the ability to connect through a multi-10 gig and Marvell network processor for high-end QoS capability, lossless traffic, some very sophisticated functionalities that not available, more closer to a high-end router than actually a switch. From a compute standpoint, the infrastructure is a dual socket Xeon. It's a standard off-the-shelf motherboard. We sell configurations between 32 and 256 gig, but you can customize that all the way up to a terabyte of RAM. We have multiple peripheral devices we can connect to this infrastructure. Most notably, I think we have the ability to run Fusion I/O, very fast flash storage. This is what TIBCO, one of our partners, actually sells today to their own customers, and it gives us a unique ability actually to perform a very high speed storage in the platform. Speaking of storage, we can also connect a SAS card for JBOD type of application. Again, we are based completely on server operating systems such as Linux or OpenSolaris, and we inherit a lot of the NFS, IFS, iSCSI functionalities out of those stock open source operating system. And we also can support a PTP master clock cards and a bunch of other features. So that gives you sort of an idea of how different from a pure hardware standpoint this object is from a traditional switch, which is built effectively for the lowest possible cost. But really what makes it special is actually the software, right? And I want to carry forward the analogy with the server we had before, right? Much like in a server, we have an hypervisor which bare metal abstracts all the hardware resources, whether it's compute, storage, or memory. Now what we have done and presents those resources to the guest operating systems in the form of virtualized entities, including the NICs. What we've done is, again, we carry this logic forward. We replace the NIC with a switch, and then we are able to virtualize not only memory, not only CPU, not only storage, but also a switch chip, a full switch chip, and present it to upstream a virtual network as a partition of the physical resources. This is somewhat of an abstract right now, but I do have the application associated with that coming up towards the end of this presentation. But I just want to show you what the technology can do. You can actually take a chip and slice it, take ports, take VLANs, take VXLAN, take MAC tables, IP tables, and pretty much in an arbitrary configuration, reconfigure the hardware underneath, all through software. And I'm going to show you how to use that infrastructure in a second. This is what we call our NetVisor operating system. Now, let me actually, very quickly, I'm going to flash this slide quickly. This is our NetVisor. I want to show the components and the APIs that you can use to interact with this device. Those are the different components. I'm going to just talk about a couple of them. Number one, this NetVisor is a piece of software which can be compiled as a distribution of OpenSolaris, so Solaris, what we ship today, or also Linux, what we're going to have in the upcoming few months. It's just a matter of recompiling this code as a module as part of either a Linux distribution or an OpenSolaris distribution. You have all sorts of northbound API, much like any other switch vendors, frankly. This is not nothing radically different, but what's radically different is that we expose the network through our SDK and API directly to the application. You can compile your own code. You can use GDB, GCC, Unix-style tools to program this platform. This is really unprecedented. And we expose the same APIs that we have to control the network ourselves through our own protocols are exposed now to the application. The application can have full visibility to every flow, every packet flowing through the network. Take it out, read it, do whatever you want, and again, we have this very fast infrastructure underneath that allows you to do that. Remember, everything is mapped from a networking standpoint into the operating system. Now, I just want to make sure there is no doubt, absolutely no doubt. This is a server switch. It's not a server, right? Because the server switch occupies in a rack the role of a top of rack switch and is not trying to replace a compute infrastructure. Servers still continue to connect to a top of rack switch, which in this case is just a more intelligent, a richer device. If you want to look at how some topologies were built with this, again, traditional spine leaf architecture, this device is ideally suited to sit at the leaf at the leaf layer. So what's really the difference between a server switch, a server, and a switch? Well, the difference is actually, frankly, very simple. So the server switch is really the intersection of a server and the switch. In what way? Well, the switch is really capable of running layer 2, layer 3 functions. It does it pretty well. No question, right? The server, on the other hand, has known layer 2, layer 3 capabilities. However, the server is specialized, is built to run applications. And also, more and more, layer 4 to layer 7 services, particularly in the form of virtualized appliances. What we have built here is something which aims to support all three functions in one platform. Of course, we're not planning to replace for general compute applications compute nodes, But there are some very specialized compute applications that you guys are going to hear later through our use cases, which actually can benefit for deeper integration and visibility into the network. Hopefully this is clear where this object fits into the data center. Now, let's talk about three applications we can build, we have built on top of that, right? This is, so far I've spoken about sort of the underlying technology, the core technology, but now Pluribus actually invested a lot, particularly over the past 24 months after actually the basic infrastructure was up, to build a set of very interesting applications. One of those applications is the Fabric cluster. What is the Fabric cluster? The Fabric cluster, you take multiple of these nodes. You remember the leaf spine architecture I showed you before. Imagine we're taking a collection of those of switches sitting at the top of the rack. And what we do is we built through 20 years old computer and database algorithm, we build effectively a cluster. This is a completely distributed cluster, peer-to-peer, based on peer-to-peer interaction between the different nodes, and it's completely free of any centralized controller. What this means is that every node in this infrastructure shares the same view of the network. You know, every node knows all the hosts connected to the network, all the MACs, all the IPs, all the connections, all the flows going through the fabric, if they are visible here, are also visible here. As a byproduct of this approach, what we get is an infrastructure and architecture which offers a single point of management. But I actually like to think this is going a lot deeper than a single point of management, because this infrastructure presents itself to anything which sits on top of it, whether it's services, orchestration, software, and applications, as one device underneath. So it dramatically simplifies the interaction between the service, the application, and the network, because the application is no longer concerned, oh, I'm dealing with five nodes, one node, VLANs here, VLANs there. Everything is abstracted and presented as a uniform logical network upstream. Interestingly enough, actually, because now every node has full knowledge of the entire fabric, we have for free, comes for free, part of, as a byproduct of what we do, built-in ARP suppression and broadcast management. You don't need to broadcast ARP to find the destination of a particular remote MAC IP association, right? Because now everybody knows everything. This is a very interesting capabilities provided for, very useful for large-scale deployment of virtualization. And then again, I want to emphasize, this is not rocket science, right? This is about repackaging technologies which have been there forever in the database space, in the compute clustering space, to actually accomplish this. And to the point that actually, very importantly, we haven't invented any new protocol here, network protocol here. There are no network protocols, no special ASICs, no special headers. What we have here is plain vanilla IP networking, and then we build over TCP/IP those algorithms, this control logic coming from those database and clustering algorithms. But we're not changing the network. This is really vanilla networking with no special invention of the protocol du jour. So this network can be your Cisco network, your Huawei network, you choose. Okay? We are not forcing an end-to-end infrastructure churn with this technology. It can be inserted very gracefully even in existing networks. The second application I want to talk about, let me redo here a little bit the animation here, is the vFlow application, right? This is very interesting because through this, it doesn't matter where you are in the network. Let's say you are this node up here, you're monitoring this node. You have full visibility of every flow through the fabric, and we also provide the ability to capture, manipulate, drop, rewrite, redirect, rate limit any flow pretty much in an arbitrary fashion through the network. This is very powerful, very interesting, and sort of embodies some of the capabilities and the spirit of the in-network SDN we discussed before. In-network SDN is sort of our marketing name, but actually, hopefully you understand how deeply it runs into the platform. Not only you can program, but really compile your own code to control the network on this platform, it's really the ultimate software-defined network, if you will, but also have full visibility and full ability to manipulate flows through the network through the infrastructure and the APIs we provide. Second application I want to talk about is the analytics. You've heard that. I think what is impressive about this technology, at least for me, coming from a more traditional networking background, is the ability to scale and track millions of connections through this infrastructure. And again, the beauty is that it doesn't matter where you sit, you always have the same view of every flow, every connection, every MAC address, every virtual machine that ever connected to the fabric. It's available to everybody. It's available real time. And we also keep, because we have this onboard, massive onboard storage capabilities, we can also actually store persistent data for weeks or months. And hopefully you're going to see some of that, those examples as we go through the demo later on. Very interestingly, we also have ability to provide analytics seamlessly for bare metal workloads as well as physical workloads. Remember, we run pretty much everything through the CPU, okay, through our very powerful Xeon processor, through a very fast connection, and we can actually monitor pretty much anything that goes through, and whether it's virtual machine traffic, VXLAN traffic, tunnel traffic, plain vanilla IP, it doesn't really make any difference. We can also track virtual machines, mobility events across the fabric, and we don't require any host on the fabric. And again, because we have a host compute infrastructure, we can actually put some monitoring tools on that infrastructure. If you buy traditional monitoring networks today, they typically filter, redirect packets, move around a little bit, but then you have to, those packets are going to tools effectively to do something useful of it. I think there's a use case, the Department of Engineering at Stanford is using one of these tools right on top of our platform, sucking the analytics right out of the platform. And Rolf is going to talk to you about that. So this is why we call it in-network analytics. No taps, no monitorings, no special flow collectors, and frankly, not even hardware limitations coming from traditional NetFlow tables built on custom memory, on ASICs of custom switches. Last is the virtual networking application. I'm trying to cover a lot of ground. This is really the last application. Once you have built the fabric cluster, this actually is an application that built on top of the cluster, what you have is effectively, as I said before, you're presenting to anything which sits upstream a single unified pool of resources. What can we do with those resources? You can do pretty much the same things you do with your vCenter. Now, what we do is we can carve in any arbitrary fashion those resources in containers. Those containers in our world are really virtual networks, right? So I want to create a red network, a blue network, and a green network. How do I do that? Logically, what's happening is I'm virtualizing those switch chips. And let's say in this very simple example, I'm taking the first 16 ports out of each of those three switches, and I effectively collect them as a one logical switch of 48 ports for the red network. Associated with those ports, I can also associate VLANs, MAC addresses. I can also reserve bandwidth through our MPU on our high-end platform. And I've effectively created a network. The same can happen, of course, with the blue network. I'm taking port 17 through 46. And those three switches are collapsed and are presented as one logical network to anything that sits on top. The beauty of this, now I have isolated those networks and I can run OpenStack with Red Hat here. I can run a Windows stack right up here, and I can also run a VMware vCloud direct or even infrastructure right on top of this network. All concurrently, all potentially managed by different people because we have role-based access supported into the platform. This is what we call, when we talk about in-network virtualization, this is really the concept, bringing the problem of solving virtualization directly onto the network switch rather than on the host where you build overlays. So what can you do with that? Well, I just mentioned overlays. Well, we have the ability to eliminate completely overlay and underlay networks, right? Because now your underlay network is virtualized and fulfills the same function of an underlay network with the same flexibility and functionality. What does this mean? Let's say you have your virtual machine and you have your bare metal server. You can, as long as you're connecting to a red port, right? The red switch here connects to a red port, all it sees is the red network, okay? Very simple. There are no tunnels, nothing special, no fancy protocols. This is MAC, IP, VLAN stuff. As long as you're connected, you're physical, you're bare metal, I don't care, right? you're just a port. This is just a port and just a net. We dramatically simplify from a host and application standpoint the entire interface through the network. And of course, you can build a blue network and the green network we have seen before. I don't need an overlay. You wanna deploy an overlay network? Of course, we support VXLAN, VTAP, and all those things. But we do provide a smarter way for the network to take care of the problem of virtualizing the network. Let the host do the host, and let the network do the network. This is sort of the philosophy here. So one of the interesting things we can do is wire once, rewire virtually. This is a completely software-defined fabric in a way, right? I've shown you before, you configure through software which port belongs to which network, which VLANs you want to allocate. You can reconfigure this network pretty much on the fly, which gives you ultimate flexibility in spinning up and down workloads and moving actually stuff around. This is ideal for cloud deployment, and we do have one of our customers that actually relies on this technology very much, and I think Rolf is going to talk about that in a second. So I covered effectively the programmability aspect, vFlow, the analytics, and the fabric and the virtualization. Those are some of the examples you're going to see actually in the deep dive from Sunay later on.